Hello guys, my name is Dennis and you are watching Close to Algo Trading. Today I'm going to talk about portfolio optimization. How do you think? Does the portfolio optimization can really help us beat the market? Stay with me and maybe we can answer this question. But before we start, perhaps we need to know what portfolio optimization means. Portfolio optimization is a process of selecting proportions of various assets to include in a portfolio in such a way as to make the portfolio better than other, according to specific constraint. For my experiment, I will try to maximize Sharpe ratio. Sharpe ratio is measure of risk-adjusted return of a financial portfolio. We will calculate it in the following way. Sharpe ratio equal portfolio return divided by portfolio standard deviation. Because in our case, risk-free rate doesn't play any role, and it can be zero. Well, we need to allocate our money to different assets in the way that our portfolio has maximum Sharpe value. The good news is that a lot of methods already exist, which can solve this task for us. Maybe one of the best packages in Python for this task will be PyPortfolioOpt. This library has all classic methods and all of them are simple to use. Now that we know what we are going to optimize, let's move to our participants. And today, the following methods will take part in our battle. The classic mean variance optimization, hierarchical risk parity created by Marcos Lopez de Prado, the critical line algorithm, which was specially designed for portfolio optimization, and efficient frontier with non-convex optimizer. And we also have two more exotic methods. LSTM model for Sharpe value optimization and trained LSTM model for prediction future allocation. The first one I found in internet. Guys adopt deep learning models to directly optimize the portfolio Sharpe ratio. They claim that this method showing the best performance over the testing period from 2011 to the end of April 2020, including the financial instability of the first quarter of 2020 compared to another methods. The implementation of this model you can find in the risk model file or in author's GitHub repo. Let's call this method LSTM just because they use a simple LSTM network. The second method is different from all others. I trained a simple network that predict allocation based on the model from the first method. First, what I want to know is which of these methods works better. For that, I choose to use 125 days price period for all methods. Set of assets was selected randomly and it consists of 10 stocks. Then, I randomly collected 10 periods of 125 prices from 2008 to 2020 years and try to optimize the portfolio using the different methods. The result was interesting. As you may see, in most periods the best Sharpe value have mean variance and CLA methods. And LSTM method shows very good result. In some cases it outperforms others. One very strange result show other methods. They are very similar to random allocation. For the first test, I used only stocks. Let's do the same test but reduce our asset to 4 ETFs. We can see that mean variance and CLA are the leaders, and LSTM shows mixed result but still looks pretty good. What we can say looking on these results? Well, CLA and mean variance looks very good, but will they perform so good if we will use this allocation for our portfolio for future? Let's check it. For the test, I decided to use Backtrader and I created a very simple only long strategy. I used 125 days of historical price to calculate allocation of assets. And based on this allocation, I rebalanced the portfolio. Rebalancing was done every 22 days. One in a month. There is one difference between the test of classic models and LSTM. For each of classic model, I did two tests. In first test, I used normal calculation of asset allocation based on 125 days price. And in the second test, I collected historical price and the calculation always performed on the collected data. For LSTM, I didn't use collected data. And I always use new model for calculation, because if I try to reuse the model, the allocation didn't change at all. And if you remember, we have a model that should predict future allocation. For stocks, I collected the data of 1000 training data elements from 2000 to 2006 year. One training element consists of 125 days and the allocation for the next 22 days. Next, simple network was trained and used for the testing. And the same was done for ETF tests. The test statistic for 2008-2010 you can see on spreadsheet, and the Sharpe value below in the graph. Result is interesting. Most of the methods show the result not far away from random, and some of them perform very poor. However, our trained model outperforms all other methods. Let's check another period that is not so close to our training's data. From 2011 to 2017, the winner is HRP methods with data collection. But we can really see that all results are very close and not far away from the random allocation. Also, I checked period from 2018 to 2021. The LSTM model works not very well, trained model is a bit better, but still not so good. And our winners here are CLA and mean variance. So, in addition, I did a test for specific period from 2012 to 2016. Because if you check the return graph, you can find that our trained model and also LSTM model perform very poor. From 2012 to 2013, our model loses money, but the SPI is growing. It is also visible here. Maybe it is because I took for the training true allocation from LSTM model. But in this special period, we can see that the random allocation outperform other methods. The final test was done on ETFs. Trained model a little outperforms other methods, but not the benchmark. Actually, it looks better than our benchmark if we will compare the drawdown, but we have to compare Sharpe value. Based on these results, we can clearly see that the past allocation doesn't provide a better allocation in the future, and in some cases, it is worse than random. Our model that tried to predict future allocation looks much more promising, but to get stable results, we have to add more data and more features. To do a conclusion, I can say that at the moment it's quite difficult to rely on any of these methods. Well, that's all for today. I hope it was interesting and see you in the next video. Bye!